On a trip to New Orleans at the age of 16, Daniel Brondel fell in love with the United States. 2 years later, the native of southern France enrolled as a full scholarship student in music at Georgia State University. 2 decades and a master's degree in performance from the Eastman School of Music later, he is the Associate Director of Music at St. Patrick's Cathedral on Fifth Avenue in the heart of Manhattan. His solo organ album, The Glory of the Organ, was recorded in the cathedral. The veteran musician chats with Canape about his musical life and transatlantic journey.
I'm the Associate Director of Music here at St. Patrick's Cathedral. St. Patrick's Cathedral is probably the most mediatized Roman Catholic cathedral in North America, and there's 8 masses a day, at least 4 of which have music, but sometimes 5. And I'm also in charge of the cantor program. I recruit cantors, I train cantors, of the organ recital series and guest choir concert series. Organists and choirs from all over the world come to sing concerts here at the cathedral. I was in college in Atlanta, and they offered me a full scholarship if I switched to music as a major from what my major was at the time. So I auditioned as a pianist, and they gave me a full scholarship. So I was like, wow, it's a no-brainer. And it was in my second year of college that I discovered that I wanted to study the pipe organ. It was very hard to learn. I was 19 years old when I started, and by then it was sort of like teaching an old dog new tricks. And at the organ, you play with your feet, as well as with your hands, of course, but you also use your feet. Instead of notes being attacked and a hammer hitting strings in the piano, this is a wind instrument. This is like a string orchestra with wind instruments and brass and all that. The organ here at St. Patrick's for me is a perfect match because it is a symphonic organ. It is a romantic instrument. It dates back to the late 1920s. It also was enlarged in the 1990s to include a few new bells and whistles, which are fun. Like here there is a harp, you know, which is kind of fun. It tickles the ear. You can also do some mysterious kind of sonorities. Some things that you wouldn't expect a pipe organ to do, and for me that's important. I'm kind of conscious of the slight, you know, Dracula music aspect that a pipe organ can have, and to me I prefer to find the luscious, enchanting, you know, orchestral qualities of the organ. There's this great energy about the place. It's a Gothic style cathedral, but you know, American dimensions. There's always a lot of people here. It's constantly renewed, and it's a microcosm of the greater New York. I love all kinds of music, but sacred music is one of them. And being able here to do good, really good Catholic music, from Gregorian chant to polyphony, to romantic music, to, you know, contemporary choral music and organ music, it's quite a luxury. And I also direct a really great choral ensemble that's not affiliated with the cathedral. We're called the Salvatones. I'm thrilled that I'm able to make a living as a musician. And because I started piano when I was 11 years old, everyone told my mother, yes, your son has a lot of talent, but he started piano too late. He's too old. He'll never make it as a musician. And even though I loved music growing up as a child, it was my understanding, and I accepted it, that I would never be able to make a living in music, that I would never be able to be a professional musician. So, you know, to my great surprise, when I came to America and people were telling me, oh, but music is your dream, you should pursue it, you know, don't worry about this, don't worry about that, adopting and accepting and embracing this optimistic view on, you know, everything is possible, pretty much resurrected that dream of mine, you know, to basically make music my life.
As a teenager in the French Alps, David Langlois was insulted when he was approached by a washboard player. After all, David thought, I'm a drummer. But listening to the washboard changed it from novelty to an instrument for him. After developing his chops for years on the French music circuit, he decided to try the Brooklyn music scene.
Music always has been a big part of my life. Since I remember, and pretty much led any conversation at the family dinners, and going sometime into some fights, and it was always like it was like politics. It was more than politics.
En voiture, Simon.
I met this guy on a gig one day. I was playing with a band, he was playing with his, and I loved his playing. And they came after at the end and said, well, you know, we're going on tour and we'd love to have you with us. That would be fun, but you can't bring your old drum set because we have double bass, we have equipment, and it just doesn't fit. So find something in your audience. Sometimes they use a washboard or some stuff, and you can play that with thimbles. And I felt a little hurt that they wanted to play on some washboard pots and pans or something like that. And I said no. But then they called me like a month later, and this time I was like, I need to play with that band. He played so well. I came back home, and in my mountains, I was living in the mountains at the time, and saw a thrift shop. And without any hope, I asked him, do you have a washboard? And I didn't even expect him to know what it was. And my big surprise is like, yeah, I have one of those. Was there, we had the thimbles. We had the fondue pot, my grandma's. It can sound like a cowbell, including a woodblock. That could be sounding like a clave. So we can also go into salsa stuff. Or we have thimbles, including a cheese grater, grandma's present again. It's a snare, it's a brushing on a snare. So I started to switch from, what do I like the most, keeping a beat and being like the core of a rhythm section, or more being the guy who comes in and adds some colors. Kind of created my band with the best musician I've heard in my prior visits to New York. And the Blue Vipers, it's a mix of a swing of blues. I didn't want to go back to Paris. I was born and raised in Paris, left in my teens for the mountains, learned how to love nature, and didn't want to go back to Paris. If one city, that would have been the biggest one and the only one that has something to really keep me dreaming. Music is my life. Music is that, there's nothing that that is more important to me. And everywhere I went was through music. I can hear it anywhere I go, and it talks to me. I feel close to those people who are playing music, either on that little island or on the top of that mountain. I don't know. So I came here to dream, and still do.
Winner of the jury prize at the 2011 Cannes Film Festival, the crime drama Police, written and directed by Mai Wen, also picked up 2 César Awards in France while meriting 12 more César nominations. In the world of ensemble police dramas, the new French film stands out. Its subject is the day-to-day stress of a child protection unit in North Paris. The film measures the toll upon victims and protectors of vice-related crimes. The filmmaker shares her thoughts about the project with Canape.
Je me voyais pas jouer un flic. Je trouvais que j'avais pas la personnalité. Et puis peut-être inconsciemment, c'est une façon de prolonger mon regard de voyeuse. Mais c'est un tas de choses en fait. Je voulais aussi depuis le départ créer une histoire d'amour entre deux personnes de milieux sociaux opposés. Parce que je voulais créer un choc de culture. Et je voulais aussi que par l'intermédiaire d'un travail comme celui de Fred, travail à la Brigade des mineurs, qui est donc un travail dur, glauque, âpre, grâce à cette chose âpre, je voulais montrer que ce ne sont pas toujours les gens bons qui nous font du bien. Je ne sous-entends pas que Fred est quelqu'un de mauvais dans le film, mais c'est quelqu'un qui est torturé, torturant, qui est habité, qui a beaucoup de démons, qui se fait du mal, qui se détruit. Et parfois, on tombe sur des gens comme ça, sur notre chemin, et ils nous font du bien.
On a beau tous les jours faire du cas par cas, du... Non.
Vous mettez l'enfant dans un foyer. Dernier mot.
On en reste là, c'est ça, c'est votre dernier.
Ouais. Un avertissement, monsieur Coutard.
C'est ça, ouais, ça sera pas le premier.
À la fin d'un film, j'aime quand le réalisateur nous a dit « Voilà, je vous parle d'un sujet, mais je vais vous en parler sous toutes les facettes. » Et après, vous êtes libre, libre de penser, libre d'argumenter. Je suis tombée amoureuse du sujet, alors c'est comme si vous me demandiez d'expliquer pourquoi je tombe amoureuse de telle ou telle personne. C'est pas toujours la plus belle, c'est pas toujours la plus intelligente, c'est pas toujours la personne qui me fait le plus de bien, mais c'est comme ça, c'est chimique, je suis amoureuse.
Oui, monsieur.
One of America's most praised and produced playwrights of the past 40 years, Israel Horovitz is also the most performed American dramatist in France. An encounter with Samuel Beckett sealed a friendship that would mark Horovitz's art and his love of France. On April 3, 2012, the writer received the insignia of Commander of the Order of Arts and Letters at the French Embassy in New York. Canape chats with him the next day.
Cher Israël Horowitz, au nom du gouvernement français, je vous fais commandeur en l'ordre des arts.
It was a very important and meaningful night for me, for sure. And I think the 100 friends who were there were all shocked by the meaning of the event, that they could recognize the fact that something was very French was happening that they probably wouldn't experience in America.
Jesus, the fascist Pig Le Pen is winning!
Are you kidding?
No, he is winning! They're gonna get your smell out of the first round!
No. You can't be serious.
Everybody's attention now turns to the election results. They cluster in front of the TV screen.
It's not possible.
Is he winning locally or nationally?
Nationally, everywhere.
Birthday cakes ready to eat, children. Oh, what's the matter?
They're predicting that your spam will be defeated in the first round. The President Chirac will run against Le Pen.
Le Pen is winning.
Really?
Fascist pig!
I did a play there last night called The Vote in Orange, and it was totally inappropriate to do this play because it was it's a play that's set 10 years ago on the night that Jean-Marie Le Pen got 45% of the vote in Orange and nationally took Jospin off of the ballot, and of course the country was people were forced to run and vote for Chirac whether they wanted to or not, and Chirac carried 85% of the vote as his legacy in his final term. But in this play, the vote is coming in, the first tour vote is coming in on the television while a family is having an 85th birthday party for their mother. And as the votes come in, they discover that she was a supporter of Le Pen, and more importantly, during the war, she was a collaborator.
It's a catastrophe, scandal.
I saw this coming, I knew it. I feel sick.
I can't believe this is happening.
I sat during the play and I thought, this is totally inappropriate. It's like biting the hand of the people who feed you. But in fact, I think the French people were very, very pleased.
Tonight is an honor beyond my wildest dreams. To be recognized and rewarded for doing exactly what I love, where I love. Merci la France, merci tout le monde. Merci, merci, merci.
A junior year abroad is a life-shaping experience for any university student. But it's of a different order of magnitude if that student happens to be Jacqueline Bouvier, Susan Sontag, or Angela Davis. Dreaming in French explores how France influenced the lives of these three gifted, influential, yet very different women.
What unites the three women in Dreaming in French is an experience that's very personal to me, because every year as a French professor, I see students go off on their great adventure to Paris. After their sophomore year, I see them, and then I see them come back when they're seniors. And something has changed. And then I thought, who are the real heroes for these women? Who are the women who went on a study abroad experience in Paris and came back and really changed the country?
Voici la Maison Blanche. Je suppose que cette réception de 2000 étudiants étrangers fait partie de vos obligations de présidente. En avez-vous beaucoup?
Oui, mais vous savez, les obligations sont souvent des plaisirs. Comme aujourd'hui, les étudiants étrangers. Ça m'intéresse beaucoup. J'en étais une.
Oui, vous-même étiez.
Parfois.
This France that Jackie Bouvier arrived in was a France of aesthetics, a France of beautiful objects. And then 1957-58, the last year of the Fourth French Republic, Susan Sontag was kind of a runaway from her grant year in Oxford. It's the story of Bohemian women finding their sexual freedom. Susan Sontag's great model was Juna Barnes, the American surrealist and lesbian. And Susan Sontag left husband and child to find her own personal freedom in France, and she never looked back. And then the third woman is Angela Davis, African American from a very eminent family in Birmingham, Alabama, and she was a French major at Brandeis. She went on the Hamilton College junior year abroad in 1963-1964, a very difficult year for race relations in the United States. When she got to France, of course, she discovered that there was racism in France, that it was an international problem, because she landed square in the middle of the Algerian conflict.
Jeune femme en but aux persécutions aux États-Unis, vous venez en Europe et vous vous imprégnez de la culture européenne. Est-ce par opposition à une certaine image culturelle américaine que vous refusez, ou est-ce que parce que vous avez trouvé ici, en Europe, une meilleure substance intellectuelle ou idéologique?
Bon, je suis venue en Europe pour essayer d'apprendre d'abord ce que c'est que le marxisme, parce que j'étais convaincue il y a très longtemps que... La solution de notre lutte, c'est de pouvoir comprendre exactement comment on va développer une stratégie contre ceux qui ont le pouvoir économique, le pouvoir politique aux États-Unis. Alors c'était quelque chose qui était lié aux nécessités de notre lutte.
What France gave them was something the very opposite of dreaming. That it allowed them to become themselves, that it secured them, that it gave them confidence in reality, not in dreams. But I would say that to have that confidence in reality, you need a counterlife. That imaginary place nourished them for the rest of their lives and made them stronger.
In 1947, Judith Malina and Julian Beck founded the Living Theater, which is now recognized by critics and historians as a place where the theatrical contract changed. The troupe's more than 100 productions, staged in New York City, in France, and around the world, have made a permanent mark on the global idea of drama. In the second decade of the 21st century, the theatrical group faces eviction. Canape revisits an interview with founder Judith Malina.
When I met Julian in 1942, he was already established as a painter. He was exhibiting at Peggy Guggenheim's gallery. And painting seemed everything to him. He was a very dedicated member of the New York Abstract Expressionist School. Shifted his career from being a painter to being a theater artist rather rapidly. Somewhere in around 1945, when we decided to create the Living Theater together. And really, his theater work has always been a kind of an extension, a kind of furthering the frontiers of his art. I think his plays and his paintings are very much alike. Certainly he worked like a painter in the theater. He would drive us mad by looking at the empty stage for hours when we were trying to get up there and start rehearsing. He would say, no, I have to see the space. I have to see the space. And then filled the space very much the way a painter fills a canvas. And then came the late 50s and the 60s, and we realized that as artists, we had a social responsibility. And so we became political activists as well as theater people. In fact, we were theater people because we were political activists. And being in that that intoxication of the time when we all felt not only that we could do what we should do, but that we could do that we could, in fact, create the world we wanted to create. We could do it through the arts. We wandered around Europe from place to place. spreading the anarchist-pacifist message, talking about the beautiful nonviolent anarchist revolution, and were carried away by the tide of the times, and went, of course, to Paris in May 68. In fact, we arrived the night of great explosion on the Rue du Lissac, and we were part of that scene. And we ran in the streets with the enragés. We occupied the Odeon Theater. We were part of that whole excitement of a lot of people who thought we were really going to change the world radically. And we did change the world, but not as radically yet as we wanted to. That's still to come.